My name is Jacob, and I work as a writing tutor for the San Jose State University Writing Center. Today, I'll be conducting a workshop on recognizing the parts of a research paper. For this workshop, you won't need anything other than a blank sheet of paper and something to write with. With that, let's get started. Research papers are a critical genre of writing for any college student. Thus, as a category, they're very broad and are highly specialized by discipline. First off, what are genres? When we talk about genres in writing, it's the same thing as in other media. Can you think of a few genres of books or movies? For those mediums, you might think of documentaries, mysteries, comedies, thrillers, romance, and so on. They're the different aisles of a bookstore or the different rows in Netflix. In short, genres are ways to categorize, and they have certain conventions about them that make them identifiable. For instance, it's easy to tell the difference between a romance and a horror story. And in movies, we can easily identify a documentary from a comedy. This is because each of these genres have specific conventions or features that make them distinct. In academic writing, genres include lab reports, essays, and research papers, among others. With practice, you'll be able to identify our particular writing genre's key information, features, and conventions, and recognize what makes certain examples of this genre strong and others not quite as compelling. Regardless of the genre of writing, any large paper with sections can be thought of as a series of nested arcs, as shown here. In graduate school, these arcs may become longer and longer, and more intense research is needed to fill a research paper. In short, these arcs become more complex. In general, graduate research papers will consist of the following sections. They are an abstract, introduction, literature review, methodology, findings or results, discussion, and conclusion. Please note that different disciplines, publishers, courses, or even professors may have unique requirements beyond these base sections. Let's start with the abstract. An abstract is typically the first thing that a reader sees when they look at a research paper. It should provide an overview of the entire paper, highlighting the motivation for the research, its context, as well as what new contributions have been made to fill a research niche. This niche refers to the area of research that may not have been explored and that this research paper studies in depth. Additionally, as an overview of the paper, an abstract should cover the methodologies and findings and the purpose or so what of the paper. This is a key difference between an abstract and an introduction. While an introduction introduces the broad ideas for a paper, the abstract should provide closure on the findings of your research. When searching for papers, readers will typically read the abstract first to determine whether or not they will read the entire paper. As such, an abstract should be short, typically under 200 words, and entice the reader to look at the entire paper. Let's take a look at a sample abstract. Please take a look at this abstract and think about what it does and how it accomplishes this. Go ahead and pause the video now and start playing again when you're ready. This abstract does a good job succinctly detailing the research paper, including information on the introduction, methods, findings, and conclusion sections. The first two sentences establish the context for the research, and the third defines a research niche or gap. This gap is also the purpose for this particular paper. Next, the author defines the how or the methods for how they will close the research gap. Then, the author includes information on the results of the paper before offering a conclusion to those results in the last sentence. After the abstract, a research paper will begin with an introduction. Introductions provide a starting point for understanding your paper, and typically they start with broad information or context about the topic before narrowing into a more specific purpose statement and thesis. Introductions should also provide a roadmap for what the paper will discuss. Whereas an abstract reveals in brief the entire paper, an introduction should be less specific and instead look at the paper's structure at a high level. In other words, an introduction will foreshadow what is to come in the paper without explicitly stating results. One formal model to think about when organizing an introduction is the creating a research space or cars model. In move one, a paper will establish the context in which the research has been conducted. This is written in general and reviews relevant previous research. In move two, the paper establishes its niche, the area for new research covered by this paper. Finally, in move three, The paper occupies that niche and discusses what has been done in the body of the paper. Now, let's take a look at a sample introduction. Please take a read through this introduction and see if you can identify the highlighted areas. Feel free to pause the video here and unpause when you're ready to continue. The beginning of this introduction provides context about the topic with previous research. Next, the middle three areas establish the research niche for the paper. Finally, in the third highlighted area, the author occupies this niche. Please know that we do have separate in-depth workshops on introductions and abstracts. Take a look at the Writing Center website for current offerings. Next up is the literature review. Graduate students may be familiar with this section from research reviews or surveys that they have written in their undergraduate career. The primary function of the literature review is to go over all of the relevant research that was reviewed ahead of any original research. This is more than a simple summary of each source that was reviewed. Rather, a literature review should synthesize or integrate this research together in ways that support establishing a niche for original research. When it comes to organization, literature reviews are commonly arranged thematically, chronologically, or by opposing points. The Writing Center also has an in-depth handout on literature reviews available on our website for more information. After the literature review, a research paper will have a section on the methodology used to complete the research. Whether the method is a designed experiment, an emailed survey, in-person interviews, simulations, or anything else, the steps and rationale for these methods should be outlined in this section. If the introduction and literature review provide the why for the research, the methodology section provides the how. Without understanding how something was done, it can be difficult to understand where the ensuing research may be applicable. After the methods for the original research have been discussed, we take a look at the results of the research. This section provides a summary of what was discovered from the research. This should be presented in a logical order and may include tables and figures of data to display results. This section is typically an impartial look at the data and will be analyzed further in the next session, the discussion. The discussion is where the paper ties the results of the research back to the main research question. This section of the paper should analyze the results and show how they can be used to answer this question. This will also place the results back into the context of the broader topic and other research from the literature review. As this also answers the question of how the results answer the research question, it should discuss the limitations of how and what this can and cannot answer. As we mentioned in the methodology section, there may be limitations from the way research was conducted. For instance, if a survey in a social science study included only college-aged students, then it is important to indicate that results will only be applicable to that group of people. Discussing the limitations of research should not be viewed as a weakness. Rather, it shows that the author understands the nuance between the research they have performed and what could be done in a subsequent study. Further, the discussion should illustrate the significance of the research and what impact this has had on the field or the world at large. Results should be analyzed and interpreted for meaning, synthesizing information from prior research. Finally, the discussion should prove that the author is an authority on the subject at hand. The final section of a research paper, apart from the appendix and references, is the conclusion. This section summarizes the paper at large and provides implications for the field. The conclusion may also provide suggestions for future research. These ideas may come from the researcher's understanding of the limitations of the research or the results. Finally, let's take a look at how successful research questions are written. A research question should be selected based on something that the researcher is interested in and is researchable. This should be something that is specific and allows for a deep dive. It is open-ended so that it can't be answered with a simple Google search and has a purpose or so what to allow for discussion. Here are three example research questions. As we read through these, think about whether or not they meet the criteria outlined on the previous slide. What are the most effective cancer treatments? This question is too broad. There are many different ways to answer this question. How does treatment for cancer vary by ethnicity amongst women in the Bay Area? This is significantly narrow and justifies discussion. It cannot be answered simply in a single sentence. What is the 5-year survival rate for women with ovarian cancer in California? This question is significantly narrow. However, it is something that can be simply searched for and answered in a single sentence. Of these, question number 2 is the best research question. In general, how and why questions will be most appropriate as they allow for more open-ended answers and discussion. Again, the parts of a research paper that we reviewed today are the abstract, or the brief paper overview, the introduction, which sets the stage for the following research, the literature review that synthesizes relevant existing research, the methodology, or how the research was performed, the findings, or data retrieved from the research, the discussion about the data back in the context of the research question, and the conclusion, which summarizes the previous sections and offers implications and areas for future research. That's all I have today for a workshop on recognizing the parts of a research paper. I hope you found this helpful and have a better understanding of research papers. Thank you for watching all the way to the end and working with me through this video. For more information and content from the Writing Center, please visit our website and other social media shown on this slide. From all of us at the Writing Center, we wish you the best of luck in all your writing endeavors.